Hello and welcome to MSME Matters. Today we have with us Devashish Bhattacharya. Known him for many years. So he's an IT professional, tech professional actually, yeah. who worked with BHEL among other companies, and then one fine day decided he had enough of formal work and decided to get into consulting and started up a company of his own.
Yeah.
So over a period of time, he has actually worked as a consultant for small and medium and large businesses across a wide range of operational challenges, right from project delivery to sort of managing projects to sort of tough projects to consulting on specific engagements. So he has been there, done that.
Yeah.
That is the sort of experience he brings to the table. And the reason why we have him with us today is to understand what is happening since the last 8 months since COVID appeared. I mean, what is it that you see, Devashish? So I'm sorry, I won't call you Dada on this because that looks very weird. So yeah, all yours.
Okay. So there are two things which I would like to converge in our conversation. One is the way industry has been moving over the last 10 years, right? And the second is what has happened because of COVID. These are two separate things, but somewhere there is a convergence which is happening. So over the last 10 years, I think the pace of technology has increased. To the extent there was a time when the concept of technology meant that there was an air-conditioned room and there were good-looking people who used to have coffee and generally sit in front of computers. And the only thing that we could see was at the time of salary processing, yeah, people would be spending sleepless nights because that bloody data will not go through. So from there till today, now we are seeing a whole lot of things which are happening, particularly technology is being used intelligently, if I may use the word today, where they are trying to see what are those activities in any aspect of work which are repetitive, rule-based, and generally considered to be very boring.
Yeah.
For example, writing down an entry in a book is one of the most boring activities. So how to convert them into system-driven so that the intellect that people have can be used in areas where subjectivity is required, judgment is required, right? So from that point of view, at least I would say since the turn of the century, we have seen moving from ERP, which was at that point of time the pillar, we are moving to again a situation where we will have a multitude of technologies coming together to deliver an experience for the customer, obviously, and for the organization also. For example, if you look at today, we are looking at technologies like analytics. Before the current century, I don't think we had enough data where we could talk about analytics. We used to talk about dashboards.
Yes.
Now I think the rate of growth of data is possibly faster than what was accumulated in the last 10 years of the last century.
Yep.
Right. So at that pace, we have much more data to crunch. We have much more capability, if I can use that word, to figure out what has been happening, what have been the factors, including outliers, and how we can project this based on our better knowledge of the ecosystem from a data point of view. So our predictions are becoming slowly and slowly more accurate. Second is another thing that we are realizing is that the predictions would be generally good for about a midterm. There is nothing called as a long-term prediction, particularly because the market is turning volatile. And with advancement of technology, what is happening is almost once in every 2.5 years, there is something which is coming in, which is causing a complete disruption in the market.
Yeah.
And I'm not talking about COVID, this technology driven.
The inflection, some inflection happens.
There is.
Yeah.
So for example, if you look at, and I'm just talking about the last 2-3 years, I was consulting an organization in Dubai. This was an automotive, it was actually a multi-business company, like Middle East companies are. Starting with construction, then they veered into various areas.
Yeah.
This was one of the largest dealers of Mercedes-Benz in the globe, with the largest service facility of about 96,000 square meters of space, right? So their problem was that they were able to deal with about 130 vehicles per day servicing, including 500 parking and all those things. And they were, which used to be pre-booked. Over the last few years, they have found that pre-booking is not helping and people are walking in. And as a result, their occupancy of the shop floor or the maintenance floor has gone down by about 40%, right? Now that is, if I connect that with the fact that the demand for personal automobiles is going down, that is a bigger problem, because about 70% of the revenue for the automobile companies comes from servicing. 30% only comes at sale.
Yeah.
So they were trying to figure out what to do, how to reach out to customer. And that was the time when we looked at all the technologies and the interesting part of robotics came in. So if we replace a contact center person by a robo, instead of a person whose temperament varies from the morning till evening and energy varies accordingly, we have something which will go on persistently, consistently, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So that was one thing. Then we saw that if we add something called as an artificial intelligence to that, which is self-learning, which will start with possibly a FAQ which people have, and then as the conversations go, it will learn from it and it will direct conversation. So today we have those kind of things where a robo can initiate conversation, can direct conversation, can conclude a conversation, and then come up with a set of decisions, right? So that is the technology. Similarly, on the production side or manufacturing side, we are looking at the Industry 4.0 group of technologies coming in, which talks about, I mean, even before you set up a plant, you can actually simulate the complete layout, operations and everything. And then you are able to, let us say, with a whole lot of knowledge and understanding, you then invest your money. So we are looking at fundamentally improving the efficiency of utilization of resources. And we are using this opportunity also to streamline my end-to-end business process. So my throughput is growing up, the conversion is going up, as a result of which my cost is going down, cash flow and margins are improving. That is the fundamental part of the whole thing. So I think this is something which has been happening over the last 10 years. With COVID, all these concepts are now put to test. Suddenly you have a lockdown where nobody can go out anywhere, right? So we have then two choices. Either economy comes to a halt. That means after a few days, people starve and do everything else. On top of it, there is no cash generation. So they cannot even survive, they survive on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah.
Which we have not faced because of the way food and supplies have been handled. Right?
Yeah.
And we saw a whole lot of things happening without contact. So yes. Today I am able to do my consulting sitting at home without going anywhere, but still meeting everybody. Right, like I'm meeting you.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
If we wanted to wait for face-to-face meeting, we would have waited for donkey's years.
Yeah.
So these are some of the things which are happening. So I think these are an opportunity. Our people are extremely afraid, possibly because of cost sensitivity. And second is, we look at breadth of things. We are extremely aligned to breadth. We are never focused on depth. So we, before even understanding what the technology is and how it can help, we start judging. Before we have taken a step, we judge whether the step is right or wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
So that is one of the reasons why we are not able to, neither able to enter this domain, and we are not able to gainfully utilize the benefits. Yeah. Another thing is we have a taboo, which is called we have to employ people. So employ people, if we bring in technology, that means one technology induction means about 20 people going out of job or whatever be their number. I'm not disputing, but the perception is if a technology comes in, some people lose their job. What we do not realize is that in an area where repetitive working is happening, where productivity is taking a hit because the job is boring and it is including overheads by way of multiple reconciliations and multiple revalidations, because the data cannot be otherwise validated, From that, we are looking at a situation where the data is validated and remains valid because it is done by a set of rules. And once it has been tested, we understand that maybe about 1 or 2% errors may creep in. Right?
Yeah.
These people who are there, whose intellect is available to us, they can be gainfully utilized in a different area to improve capacity, to improve responses where people intervention are required.
Yeah.
Do not think of those. We always are looking at half picture. So that is one of the reasons why I think we have not been able to gainfully engage with technology or take benefit out of technology. And most of the people are even today looking at technology as something that the IT fellow does and it being a cost, because they do not even realize the transformative effect a technology has on a business.
Yep.
And how it will completely alter the way of conduct of business and completely alter the cash flow equation.
Very true.
So there is no objective setting. There is no direction in which we are going. It is expected that the consultant and the IT guy together will deliver the project. When the project is delivered, he had an idea about what he would expect. That is not available because he never spelled it out.
Yeah.
And then he says, ki mera to kuch nahi hua ye, and the project has failed.
Yeah.
So this is a kind of a circle which I think we should break. There is a lot of good technology can do. It can increase capacity. It can increase reach. It can increase response time, improve response time. And it can create far more jobs than we think are possible.
Yes. I think you summed it up exceedingly well. So this is pretty much what I have been seeing in my own area of operation. So I completely understand where you are coming from. So let me ask you. So by this, the way you describe this, I would see COVID as an opportunity now, right?
Absolutely.
An opportunity where some of these simpler things, some of this basic stuff, which any enterprise could use, right? Can be actually pushed into the system and people can be trained, people can be sort of become aware that, you know, it's not as bad as it sounds. So classic example that I remembered when you talked about employability was the private sector, public sector banks. Suddenly you find even the public sector banks having very small staff in their offices because most of the activity is automated.
And not only that, they move the staff to backend.
Yes.
For markets and other things where the intellect is required.
Required, yeah. Plus, the banking services also have spread across the country, right? I mean, there was a time when I was in the 80s when I used to go to my hometown, which is not a very small place. Yeah. I mean, they had just two banks there, about 35 square kilometers.
Yeah.
That was it.
Absolutely.
So you're right. So how do you see this this inflection point happening? Because I think this is another inflection point, as we were talking about, where technology, I mean, companies, enterprises, which, like you said, would just focus on the consultant and the IT guy and say, yaar, kuch karo. And when the guy does kuch karo and gives it, obviously it's not going to be of you. So what would you be your process in a situation like that? What would you be speaking to maybe the business owner or the leadership team, whoever it is that is there in that room?
I think we ask the wrong questions in the wrong place. So okay. If we are able to correct that. So for example, I went to an organization who actually called us and I said, why are you calling me? Because we want to implement SAP. I said, very good. So my question, I had only one question. I have been engaging with them since 2013 till 2017 when they said, come and we'll now start the engagement and give you an order. They had not answered the why. They said, nahi, nahi, ye toh chahiye hai because everybody is doing. I said, everybody may be doing. But what do you get out of it?
Yeah.
Woh toh aap batayenge. So when the consultant says that this is what you need to do, then he will ask all the whys as to why so much money, why this, why not that, why, etc., everything.
Yeah.
But the fundamental question which drives all of this is never answered.
Mm.
It is not even in the cognizance.
Yeah.
Right. So somewhere I think we need to have our promoters education. Mm. Right. Second. So far, our technology has been on-premise. On-premise means I buy, I keep it, and I spend a whole lot of money in maintaining that.
Maintaining, yeah.
Right. Now that has the model has completely changed. Now you don't buy, you rent it out.
Yeah.
And somebody else manages it for you.
Yeah.
So there are a different set of dynamics which comes into the picture. As a business, if I look at, let us say, a business cycle for about 10 years or 5 years, the cost that you pay for on-premise application vis-a-vis a rented application, which is cloud services, right?
Yeah.
Your prices are not much different. Only thing is, instead of a sudden jerk in cash flow, because when you invest, you are pushing out some money which is not in the regular cash flow, and then going down and trying to come up, you have normalized it across the business cycle. So your jerk is not as much, your risk is down, and you have money available to use in other things also, right? So given that, I think it is important for us, and I consider I'm making the statement with a whole lot of responsibility, it is our job to educate people as to why technology is good in any kind of perspective, in the short-term perspective, long-term perspective, smaller group of people, larger group of people, company-wide, society-wide, everywhere. Second is that implementation of technology can also be done in multiple manners, particularly, let us say, when you're talking about MSME and SME.
Yeah.
Where they're operating on smaller volumes of cash, hence their cash flow and cash availability and liquidity all are always under challenge. That is where we can always think of a cluster kind of a situation, where we go to a zone, identify a set of similar companies, create a cluster kind of a solution, and then get them to use that. So there has to be obviously a commitment for a certain number of years, otherwise that venture will not be viable. And then we need to get the common businesses, common processes together, common practices together. In the whole process, what will happen is we will have something which is available to the locality. Anybody else who comes in can join in and make this provider more profitable. In the process, they are not spending as much money. They have given the responsibility to somebody else and they are still able to derive benefits. So it is almost like a on tap kind of a service.
Right. Yeah.
So that is something that we can do. But again, we need to think about it. And I think as a nation, we will do everything except think. We don't think. Right? Where we need to spend more time in figuring out.
Yeah.
Right? Something out of nothing. There a lot of thinking has to go in.
Yes. Yes.
We don't do that. And we leave that critical thinking to somebody else. And then start blaming all over the place as to what has gone wrong and why it is going wrong. So we are more used to postmortems.
Yeah.
And in today's situation, I don't think we have the luxury of carrying out a postmortem and trying to fix the problem next time.
Yeah, I know. There might not be a next time.
There might not be a next time.
Yeah.
And COVID has shown that very, very easily.
Yes. Yes. You're right. You're right. You're very right. So coming to, I mean, so just moving from what you just said to the next step. I mean, we know that this is the way the business leaders, I mean, by the way, let me just sort of add my own experience to this.
Yeah.
I mean, I've seen the big business, big companies, big enterprises, companies which are worth millions, billions of dollars. When they set up a project, even they sometimes don't ask some of these questions. I mean, it's sort of, and this is uniquely in India, because you said it right, because I spent time abroad also. One of the things I learned the hard way initially was that you spend substantial time in planning so that you reduce the time you spend on delivery. Because it usually is streamlined. You have thought things through. So in that situation, now, where do you start? I mean, like you said, I mean, you can, I mean, for example, if somebody comes to you to consult, you can educate that person at a larger level. I mean, see, governments are doing things. I mean, we know that this government also sort of, I just read, I think in yesterday's paper or today's paper, they're coming up with another financial package. So the package is fine. So today, if I ask an MSME, what's your problem? He says money. Now, when I ask, what are you doing? He's talking about something which probably is not even relevant today. Now, how do you sort of grapple with that?
These are two, three things. I will try my best to
correct. So
okay. So the MSME guy's problem is that with business collapsing, his cash that he has laid out in the business has got blocked.
Yeah.
Why? Because he is not able to service he does not have orders, so he cannot service. And since he cannot service, the money cannot come back to him. So that is his problem. The stimulus that is being offered to him is by way of a loan. He is already leveraged fully. On top of it, how does he handle loan? Right? So that is one question. Instead of that, is there a method of doing something which will ensure that cash starts coming back, his cash flow starts? I don't think, again, from a policymaker point of view, we have not spent enough time on this. As a result of which, we are thinking of loans, which is a good way. You keep the person accountable, but for that person to be accountable, that person has to survive first. So yeah. somewhere we are missing this particular thing. I mean, all well-meaning initiatives.
Yeah.
But the starting point, I think, is missed out, possibly because that wider consultation may not be happening. Or even if it is happening, again, we are also blinkered in our thinking. Our bureaucrats have blinkered thinking. Our leaders mostly are guided by the bureaucrats. They don't have independent thinking of their own, because most of them do not have that educational background also. And people who do also, they are so much bookish that they cannot apply what they have learned into a practical situation like this. So that is one of the challenges. The other part is, I think the government should focus on, maybe instead of giving a stimulus in the form of loans, it should see how can the business be started. And in that, some of the people have been talking about government increasing its spend. Possibly the way forward. Now today the government is stretched in a manner to say.
Yeah.
Why? Because all the spare money which they had, or they withdrew out of various things by increasing cess, by keeping the petrol prices at high levels, even if the prices crash globally and all of it, those went into those Ujjwala Yojanas and other things. From a welfare point of view, these are good. But these are spends. Nothing is coming back. So if they are able to balance the spend vis-a-vis something which they do, which gives them a return, then it becomes sustainable. So at this point of time, the government spending is not sustainable. And if the government spending is not sustainable, obviously the economy goes through hiccups, which is what is happening. Which is slightly opposed from the earlier time, where the government possibly knew, but there was a motive behind taking money out through various scams. So both of these are bad. We need something which is a balance in between.
Yeah. So just one question. So, I mean, as you were speaking, I was just thinking, long back, I mean, I think about how many times, I mean, I think this was when the Vajpayee was in, came to power. They sort of increased spends, I mean, at least increased spends through the golden quadrangular, where they said, okay, we'll start preparing roads and we'll actually put money into the hands of people, who will then obviously go ahead and increase demand for FMCG, and then sort of that cycle would move. Now, one of the things I understand is farm sector has been doing well. I mean, I'm a part farmer, a small one, marginal farmer. So I am making a little bit of money. I mean, it's coming through there. I mean, so that is there. In addition, I mean, do you think there could be anything which the government does to sort of put money instead of, okay, it's one thing to sort of give loans to industry, they'll start producing, but who will buy it? So how do you balance that? Is there a thought that you have on that? I mean, small stuff.
I think agriculture may seem small, but I mean, one of the things that I see is that from a net contributor of a global food basket, we have become net consumer. So which is a worrying part. Food security from point of view is bad. Now, I think on the agriculture side also, we have a lot of technologies which are coming in, which can be gainfully used.
Yeah.
But that is not what is bothering agriculture in my cognition. In my cognition, it is the community of intermediaries between the agriculture guy, farmer, and the consumer, which is actually screwing up the complete equation, where they are pumping in the least amount of money, taking out the maximum, in the process killing the farmer and screwing up the consumer.
Yes.
And why nothing can be done about it, or nothing is being done about it, is most of these people are politicians. So if we want to do something seriously, we have to have responsible politicians. I mean, I believe that they will have reason and cause to steal. but they should not, I mean, if the student percentages, it's fine. Still, not good, but it's fine. Because most of the money is available. What they steal is, take away most of the money, keep a percentage for what is required to be done. Doesn't work out.
Yeah. So you're basically scraping the bottom. As a national exchequer, you're scraping the bottom now already.
Yeah, because the fellows have emptied the complete thing. Whatever is left, we are trying to do with that. Doesn't work.
Yeah. Yeah.
Another thing which is happening is, so this is, if we clean out the middlemen, which I think the farm bill has an intention, only thing is, thanks to the politicians on the opposing side, because they have to oppose, they are creating a whole lot of nuisance.
Yeah.
I think if they can break the backs of the middlemen, agriculture will actually thrive. Otherwise, it is becoming a non-viable business.
Yeah.
Which is bad, because after a while, we will be dependent on imports for our food.
Yeah.
So something needs to be done. We have enough technology to be able to intelligently utilize our resources, including water and power, to manage our agriculture. Hmm. So I think we should be able to, we should do that.
Yeah.
We need to have policy. We need to have political will.
Okay. Finally, before wrapping up, if I were to ask you, what would be the two or three things which you would tell the central government vis-a-vis the MSME sector? I mean, if there were maybe three things that you would ask the central government, the government of India, policymakers to look at. I mean, we mentioned that, right? We don't think. So what would be those three things you would want them to think about?
Okay. I think... from the government, and when I say the government, I'm talking about the bureaucrats. They have to get over their opinion that they know everything. Most of them don't. They may know certain things, but again, knowing something, applying it to something else, not too many people there can do.
Yes.
Most of them are blinkered thinking.
Yeah.
And thanks to the kind of fear psychosis which exists with them, that if I do something and somebody later on takes cognizance of that and creates a message from me, even if it is well-meaning, then my reputation is gone, my finance is gone, everything is gone. So that is one of the worries which does not allow them to take bold decisions.
Yeah.
Right? So second thing is their treatment of people who they talk to is not conducive to their understanding what they do not know.
Mm-hmm.
Because they start from where they know. In a learning situation, they are the ones who are teaching and the other fellow is supposed to be learning. So it becomes lopsided. So that is one thing which we need to change. I think they need coaches.
Yeah.
Right? Our politicians also need coaches. They also don't understand anything about the real system except welfare. Welfare means giving freebies. Mm. Right? And I think for everybody, and I do not know how to do this, but this is important, where we tell everybody that if the country thrives economically, and even otherwise, everybody has enough chance to earn money. If we empty the money before it has a chance to go through the economic cycle, then we are not only killing the cycle, but we are killing the country also. They will also die.
Yeah.
That is a change of mindset which we need to do, which will only come from two things. One is respect for my own self. And as a consequence, respecting that the other fellow also has an opinion, has a right to do something. And that also needs to be respected. We don't have either of them.
It's a tough situation to be in, right?
Tough situation to be in. And it is compounded by the fact that we have a, let us say, millennium-old culture, which says respect the elder. As a result of that, we don't ask questions.
Yeah.
We will go behind his back and we will say what kind of an age he is.
Yeah.
But we'll not tell him in his face that what you're saying does not seem right. Please explain if you want, or otherwise listen to me.
So asking questions, Dada. Yeah, asking you're right. Asking questions doesn't amount to disrespect. I mean, that's one of the major big things that I think that's a very powerful message, because at the end of the day, if I don't ask questions to myself, I don't improve, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
If I'm the same way.
And I can relate it to you with a small anecdote. Yeah, I was in Siemens one point of time, right? So I had gone for a training to Germany. We were a multi-country team which was being trained on some aspect. So this was a management training, and we had one guy from HR who came in, and he was narrating a situation that they had a large order from a Korean company, We're running out of time.
No. I'm just checking whether I have your phone number. I do have.
Okay. So it was a Korean automotive or manufacturing company.
Yeah.
And they had put a huge order on Siemens for control systems.
Yeah.
Right. So one of the deals was that about 40 of them would come to Germany and they would be trained for 2-3 months and send back so that they are able to manage their whole this thing. So this was about halfway through the cycle when this fellow gets a call that the guy come over. So this is a British guy in Germany, right? So obviously a British guy is irreverent. Germans are absolutely stoic and extremely serious about everything.
Right?
So this fellow says, what happens? He says, there is something which is happening. We don't know what it is.
Okay.
Why don't you go and find it out?
Okay.
So he went there, sat through the first day. And he said, everything seems to be fine. So let us do one thing. Let us take these fellows out for dinner. So they took them out for dinner. And then he gets to talking to various people. And then he was able to get talking to one of the Germans who was a trainer. He said, what happened? He said, no, they are very good. And we are actually moving much faster. So we are able to do the concept and everything else. I said, okay. Then went to the Koreans and talked to them. So the guys first will not open their mouth. After a while, they say that, you know, we have a language problem. We don't understand German. Our knowledge of English is also not that good. And this is 2000, when Germany was still coming out. Now they can speak very good English, but at that point of time, it was not there. The story is about a decade earlier than that, right? So this was just after the unification or something like that. So I said, okay, so what's the problem? He says, we don't understand anything that fellow tells us. So what is happening is, the cycle is, and these are Koreans, they don't like all kinds of food.
Yeah.
So first, at the end of the day, they go back to the wherever they have been put up. There is a boss who has come. So everybody, after washing, comes to that room. So they cook food, eat and everything. Exactly. Then the boss says, who the bloody hell has understood anything that has gone in the class today?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then from about 9 p.m., till about 3 o'clock in the morning, they're trying to figure out what has happened. No success. Right? And then they go to sleep, get up at about 6 o'clock because factory starts at 8 a.m. And they go back, and this has been happening for 20 days. So they were at a point where they were saying that, guys, we will tell our bosses that we have made a mistake. Let's cancel the order and let's go back.
Oh, man.
So this was told to us as a multicultural issue. But the point that this gentleman made was that in Germany or in Europe, anybody says anything, the first thing the other fellow will say is why? Or how do you say so? There is a challenge thrown right at this
point. Yeah.
In our situation, which is Southeast Asian countries, we think the teacher is a respected person. How can we question him?
Yeah.
If we do not understand, it's bloody hell my problem.
Yeah.
Right? So as a result of which, the Koreans did not understand anything. They did not ask questions.
Yeah.
The Germans thought they have not asked questions, so they understand. So they increased the download speed, which compounded the problem. So our problem is that same thing. If we ask questions, for example, go and ask Modi as to why you are doing certain things. Now, Modi being Modi may not say something. But let us say instead of Modi, there is somebody else. That fellow will say, how dare you ask me this question? Do you know who I am?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Because he does not have an answer, he will try bluster.
Yeah.
You go and talk to a secretary, same thing happens.
Yeah.
You go and tell your boss, I think this is the way to do, same thing will happen.
Yeah. Completely.
So unless we, and this happens from childhood.
Yeah.
You say, I want to do this. Your parents will say, no, don't do this. Why? Slap. So as a result of which, your proclivity to ask questions goes off. Your curiosity is killed.
Yes, very true.
That is the whole problem. We've killed curiosity.
Yeah.
So we don't discover. If somebody discovers, then by relation, we say, okay, you have discovered, now let me. So copy karne ke, farra chalane ke jo aadat hai na.
I think I'll stop it on that. I think that was a terrific way to conclude. I think all I can say here is, I think Devashita, you explained it perfectly well.
Thank you.
I would say, please do not farra chalao. Find your own answer, because the answers are there. And as consultants, there are enough people out there to help you out with that.
Absolutely.
I think that is probably the conclusion we can draw, right?
Absolutely.